Good morning, and thank you all for coming out today to cover this press availability. We are pleased to be joined today by FEMA Administrator Pete Gaynor. I want to thank him and all of our federal partners, especially Regional Administrator Tony Robinson, who's been spending a lot of time with us over the last number of months, really over the last number of years, and also the Coordinating Officer, John Long, who's been with us day after day, not just with respect to this hurricane, but the previous hurricanes and also COVID-19. FEMA is the federal agency primarily responsible for the response to COVID-19, and I want to thank them for all of the assistance that we have been able to get from FEMA and all of our federal partners. Over the last couple of days, we've been surveying the damage caused by Hurricane Zeta and meeting with local elected officials. We were able to be in the area yesterday, and I want to thank President Cynthia Lee Shang for hosting us here today, but also for meeting with me yesterday and then traveling to Grand Isle, which is one of the most heavily impacted areas in the state with respect to the damage from Hurricane Zeta. I do want to remind everyone as we go about our recovery, our cleanup efforts, the fact that electricity is still out. It is not the hurricanes, it's not the storms that directly relate in the most serious injuries and the number of deaths that we typically experience. It's the cleanup activities. It's operating generators. It is not having respect for a down power line and understanding that you should always treat those power lines as if they're live. So we're going to encourage everybody to continue to exercise caution, especially with this cooler weather. You may run a generator in order to keep a heater going. Keep that heater at least 3 feet away from anything that's combustible. And please make sure the generator itself is at least 20 feet away from your house in a well-ventilated area, not underneath a window or a vent, not in a crawl space, garage, certainly not in your home. And then allow that generator at least 20 minutes to cool down before you refuel it. It's a great idea to have a working smoke detector and carbon monoxide detector in your home with fresh batteries, so please do that. And if you are out cleaning up, meaning you're going to be cutting trees and that sort of stuff, be very, very careful. We've had some traumatic injuries and deaths over the last couple of months from individuals who were out working on the roof, cutting trees and that sort of thing. We have had one death confirmed that was related to Hurricane Zeta. That was an electrocution in Orleans Parish a couple of days ago of a 55-year-old gentleman. The biggest impact from this storm was wind, and so there are damage to homes and to businesses and other structures, but the biggest damage has been to the electricity infrastructure across the southeast Louisiana. We still have a number of outages. The peak outages have been revised a little bit, so now they're saying the most outages at any one time was 519,000 in Louisiana. That number is down to 326,000 across southeast Louisiana currently. Here in Jefferson Parish, 72% still without electricity. The National Guard continues to work. I want to thank all of our soldiers and airmen. They have 1,930 guardsmen who are activated in support of operations related to Hurricane Zeta. CPRA continues to track 689 gates across the coastal region of our state, 192 of which remain closed. That's down from 319 yesterday. There are 23 roads still closed because of different problems, most likely down power lines. We encourage people before you travel, first of all, don't travel if you don't need to, but if you need to travel, please go to 511LA.org for real-time information about road conditions and closures so that you don't get stranded or cause unnecessary issues. With respect to shelters, so we have three sets of hurricane evacuees that are sheltering in Louisiana simultaneously. There continue to be 3,051 from Hurricane Laura. 172 from Hurricane Delta, and then only 27 from Hurricane Zeta, and they are in three parish shelters. The remainder are in non-congregant shelters, principally in the New Orleans area, but there's one hotel in Baton Rouge and one in Lafayette that's providing shelters as well. I do want to remind everybody that we are in a COVID environment, and while we are very fortunate, and I say fortunate, I think it's because of the cooperation of so many people, Louisiana remains in a plateau of cases, and I think we're one of about four states in the country right now that don't have cases increasing, and our hospitalizations have been steady as well. But we do know that the country as a whole, and in fact the Northern Hemisphere, is in a third surge or a second wave. And so in order to make sure we do as best we can here with COVID-19, we continue to encourage everyone to wear your mask, social distance, at least 6 feet from people when you're not from the same immediate household, wash your hands frequently, and stay home when you're sick. And let's all do the best that we can to protect the most vulnerable among us, those 65 and older, and those with those comorbid health conditions like diabetes, hypertension, kidney disease, heart disease, and so forth. Today we are reporting 434 new cases on 11,874 new tests. The deaths today are 11, sadly, and we have gone over 5,700 deaths total now at 5,705. We don't have hospitalization numbers for you today. That's a function of the interrupted reporting process because of Hurricane Zeta. We still have about 18 hospitals out there on generator power, and about the same number of nursing homes as well. But we will get you the updated hospital numbers just as soon as we can, but I don't have those for you now. The last thing I'm going to report today before I yield the podium to Administrator Gaynor is that many of you are probably aware that Colonel Reeves, the superintendent of state police, is retiring today after 30 years of tremendous service to the state, three of which were as superintendent. Today I am pleased to announce that I've appointed Louisiana State Police Captain Lamar A. Davis as the next Deputy Secretary of Public Safety and Superintendent of Louisiana State Police. He is not with me today, and that's unfortunate. Captain Davis has had an exemplary career in law enforcement. I know that he's earned my respect and that of his colleagues, not just as state police officers, but in sheriff's offices and chiefs of police all across the state of Louisiana. And I'm confident that he's going to continue to lead the state police with the utmost professionalism and the highest standards. He obviously is accepting the position at a time when the state faces many challenges from hurricanes, from COVID-19, and so forth. He's a native of Baton Rouge. He's been with the state police since 1998. He is a member of the Army, a non-commissioned officer. He was a command sergeant major of a battalion in the Louisiana National Guard. He's been married to his lovely wife for 29 years, and they have one son. And so I'm very pleased to announce that he'll be our superintendent effective immediately. And so with that, I'm going to yield the podium to Administrator Gaynor. He'll be followed by President Cynthia Lee Shang, and then we will take your questions once they've both had an opportunity to deliver remarks.
Thank you, Governor. It's always good to be back in Louisiana, and thank you, President Lee Shang, for hosting us today, and Joe Valenta, the parish, Jeff Parish OEP director, for again hosting us on short notice today. We do appreciate that. Damage assessments, as indicated by the governor for Zeta, are underway, but we ask that those Louisianans impacted by Zeta do a few things while those assessments are being conducted. First, call your insurance company. Make sure they know that you have damage. That's the first thing you need to do. Take photos of those things that are damaged. Document your property loss, things like model numbers, serial numbers, so you have a list of those things that may be eligible for reimbursement. And then save all your receipts. If you do those four things now, you'll be in a better position should the state apply for a major disaster and should the president declare that. But if you do those four things today, that will speed us along. I also want to thank the president for swift action. We've had a lot of action in Louisiana over the past couple months. So everything from quick approval of emergency requests for pre-landfall declarations, major disaster declarations, and most recently, 100% cost share for Laura for that disaster. So again, we appreciate that, and I know the state looks forward to maximizing all those federal resources in aiding recovery. And lastly, I just want to echo what the governor said about safety. You can't say it enough. And first is generator safety. I've been out here a couple times over the past couple months after disasters. Lots of generators have been purchased. You can hear them running in neighborhoods. And so you really have to be careful. You know, carbon monoxide is a silent killer. And so all those things, like keeping it away from your residence 20 feet, you have to do all those things to keep you and your family safe. Downed power lines, lines tangled in trees. If there's a line on the ground, consider it live. Stay away from it. Again, don't put your life in jeopardy. And then lastly, you know, check on those neighbors that may need some assistance, that maybe can't get out there or you haven't seen. You know, be a good neighbor and get out there and check on those neighbors. And then finally, again, can't say it enough, and everywhere I go, I want to echo these four things, and it's COVID safety. And I want to congratulate the governor for having low positivity in the nation. It's important. And so four things: wear a mask, socially distance, keep your hands clean, and stay out of crowded places. If you do those four things, you continue to flatten the curve, and it gets us, all of us, not just Louisianans, but the whole country, out of COVID-19 a little bit faster. And so with that, I just want to thank the governor again today and the team, General Wascom, for being a great partner, and my FEMA rep, Tony Robinson, for, again, making it happen here in Louisiana. And like I tell the governor, we're here until recovery is done. And with that, Madam President.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Governor. We certainly appreciate you bringing your team here to Jefferson Parish, and we really appreciate you allowing me to join you on the flight yesterday to Grand Isle. I know Chairman Templet was there. I know Mayor Carmodell really appreciated it. Grand Isle and Lafitte, Barataria, Crown Point, Lower Lafitte is some of our most vulnerable areas outside the levee protection system, and during these storms, we always worry about them. So the fact that the governor was able to bring us to the island immediately after the storm, along with, more importantly, FEMA, GOSEP, CPRA, Congressman Garrett Graves was with us. It really means a lot to us in the parish because you get to see the assessment. We walked on the Burrito Levee. Everybody hears about the Burrito Levee. Even some members of the team said, I always heard about the Burrito Levee. We were able to walk on the Burrito Levee, see the exposure, see some of the breakage. So I want to thank you for that and those conversations that continue. Here in Jefferson Parish, we have some issues that probably many parishes are still suffering through, just like us. We ended this storm with most of our residents without power. Patrick Hamby was here from Entergy at our press conference last night explaining the process of Entergy restoration. They do a complete damage assessment. Last night, he said that about half of that damage assessment was done. They have to do an inventory on all the equipment they need so that they can load the bucket trucks up properly, and we're going to trust that they know how to get the most number of people on as quickly as possible. That's not a process that I understand, but I certainly I know that that's their strategy, is the number as soon as possible. Yesterday and the remainder of today, of course, the focus is on critical infrastructure for our community that we all want them to focus on, that we all may need if we get in harm's way. Hospitals, certainly nursing homes with the vulnerable communities, our fire stations, our first responders, our own water plant, our sewer plant. Those are the things that need to get online first. I know last night I was hearing friends say they are starting to get turned on, and today I'm hearing more of that. So we hope that today more of the private businesses and residents will get turned on as well. So the last number I have, we're still out at 72% of the parish. So I know many of you are listening to this press conference via radio. So hopefully today Entergy is able to make a big dent. But right now, we're still out 153,280 people. Shelters, we did stand up a shelter last night. No one stayed at the shelter last night. So everybody was able to find other places to stay if their house was damaged. Today, our Public Works Department in Jefferson Parish have 640 personnel out in the field. We're going to continue to work through the weekend getting all those things done. I want to talk about the sewer system, and as I have said, and I know speaking with nearby mayors and parish presidents, this is also an issue for them because this is an electricity issue. Again, the water that you use in your house when you flush your toilet, when you do your dishes, take a shower, do your laundry, needs to come out through the sewer system, and that is powered by electricity. So we have 500 lift stations throughout Jefferson Parish, and probably in the same ratio, we probably have 70% of those out. So we don't want to put anything into the system we don't need to. We're asking citizens, hold off on doing your laundry. Only do the essential things that you need. So the systems, until they can all get back online and we can reach capacity, we will get back to normal. We continue to go in parkways and streets to the major thoroughfares. We had many fallen trees. We still have about 100 more trees that are blocking roadways to get through. We made a sizable dent in that yesterday. Obviously, major intersections and roadways were our priority for that. Our Public Works and our Traffic Department also spent the day yesterday putting out stop signs and temporary signage, and any damage that we've seen from the arms from the traffic control signals, we're repairing that so when the Entergy gets back, that signal light is ready to go. I want to reiterate, and I'm hearing a lot of close calls on our major intersections. You treat an intersection like it's a four-way stop sign. Do not go through an intersection like you have a green light when you don't. So please, let's be safe. Again, as we said, and every elected official, the governor is saying, what happens post-storm, sometimes we get through the storm okay, and then we have incidences like the gentleman in New Orleans. We all make it through the storm and we survive the storm, and then these other hazards in the community injures or hurts people. We want to get through the storm in Jefferson Parish without any major injury or death, and we're still in the midst of that because we're not back to normal yet. So please be safe. We had 7 water main breaks after the storm. We have been able to complete 4 of those yesterday. We're working on the 3 today. They had tree issues that were preventing us from getting to that yesterday, but I can happily say that no one in this parish is without water. So we're working around that. We have our inspectors doing drive-by assessments of all the property, like a windshield survey, they call it, to take a picture of the damaged houses. Obviously, FEMA's here. We have to report our damage to get assistance, and we have to document that. And so we have folks out in the field doing that throughout the parish, documenting damaged businesses that we have. Again, as many people have said, I know everybody's out doing their landscaping and cleaning up their houses and you know, tidying up. Please be careful if you're not someone who's used to getting on a ladder with equipment. That's a dangerous situation. Many people get eye wounds from branches, broken limbs. When I went to a hospital after another storm, the post cleanup was also a way for people and homeowners to injure themselves. So please, please be careful on that. Continue to report any of your damages to our Emergency Operations Center, which is where we are here, at 504-349-5360. Generator safety has been mentioned before. The danger of carbon monoxide, do not run it in an enclosed space. Do not run it in our garage or any spaces that can capture those fumes. Run it at least 20 feet away from your home and always direct the exhaust away from your home. We know that the hospitals were saying people were coming in for oxygen tanks, and they need just the simple electricity to plug in. So I'm going to quickly go on the West Bank, Johnny Jacobs Playground, 9 Mile Point Volunteer Fire Department, Marrero Estelle Volunteer Fire Department, and the Terrytown Volunteer Fire Department for Station 51 on the West Bank, where you can plug in for your oxygen tank and get electricity. And on the East Bank, Cleary Playground, Station 13 on the East Bank, Station 15, and Station 20. And just a note about debris, again, put your leaves, small branches, those of you without electricity are going to have a lot of spoiled food. Put the small leaves, the branches, and the spoiled food in bags. Put it in your regular garbage bin. That will get picked up with your regular garbage service. Your large pieces of branches, your big woody waste, pile it up on the right of way We're going to assess Monday as to how much of that is out on the curb, and that is a different contract. That is a storm debris contract. Do not be surprised if that doesn't get picked up with your regular garbage, but put the heavy wood, the large pieces, on your right-of-way, and that will get picked up at a later time, and I'm asking for everybody's patience on that. Garbage and recycling, the regular service has resumed again, so follow your regular garbage for the small leaves and the spoiled food and your regular garbage. And happy to report that transit resumed this morning at 7 a.m. Kenner Local has to turn around at Coleman Place. Tarrytown will not be able to travel on Terry Parkway between Bell Chase and Carroll Sioux. And the West Bank Expressway route will detour and cannot service Ames. So those are the only three route changes because of a tree in the road or some way that they can't get through. Encourage everyone to look at jeffersontransit.org for updates on those changes. Also, we have a good Jefferson Transit app that shows you real time where the route is, what route changes. So for any of those who've used the bus, please consider downloading that app. We have no COVID testing in the community today. We want to remind everyone to be safe, and please stay updated on jeffparish.net. Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, or you can text JP Alert, one word, to 888-777 or JP Noticias to 888-777. So we want to thank the governor for being here, for us being allowed to participate in your and hear your meetings this morning, and certainly thank you for the most vulnerable areas of our parish, Governor. Thank you.
Okay, so we have a few minutes for some questions, if you have them.
Yeah. To see how many have been damaged and if any had to be relocated come election day. Is there any final numbers on the number of polling locations impacted? And if so, have any plans been made to relocate?
Yeah, so the Secretary of State gave a preliminary report during the UCG meeting by parish with polling locations that were either damaged and or lacked electricity at the moment. There will be efforts all day long, including a call, I think it's at 1:30 with the Public Service Commission and the energy companies that service those areas. Another call later this afternoon that'll involve the Fire Marshal's Office, which is doing a lot of the inspections, but also the National Guard and all of the clerks of court. So it is too early to say which polling places are not going to be in service on Tuesday, but those decisions are going to be made very quickly. What we anticipate happening is that power is going to be restored rapidly today, but I can't tell you that 100% of that's going to be restored by Tuesday. But the goal here is to identify those polling locations as soon as possible that are not going to be able to be in service on Tuesday, so that we have an opportunity to have an alternate location selected, have the machines and the poll workers prepared to go there, but also try to communicate with the voters who voted at that precinct where the change, the new location is, so that they can vote there instead. That's going to be playing out today and probably tomorrow. And so we always ask people to be weather aware when a storm is approaching. We're going to ask voters to be paying attention to local elected officials, to news broadcasts, and we're going to ask you all to continue to cover this as well. Because quite frankly, we don't have a lot of time between now and Tuesday, but we don't have final information. Yesterday was primarily a day of assessment for the power companies. Today is going to be primarily about restoration. And even though yesterday was about assessment, tremendous progress was made. We expect that that's going to accelerate today. But as I stand here, I am fairly confident there will be voters on Tuesday who will not be able to vote in their normal polling location. And so we're going to be making alternative locations available. Please stay tuned. We'll have more information for you later. Yes, sir.
Can you give us a few more details on why you've chosen Captain Odom? Is that Lamar Odom?
No, Lamar Odom is a basketball player, isn't he? Lamar. I think 25-year veteran of the state police, and he has served throughout state police in just about every different part of that organization, whether it's patrolling, whether it's gaming, whether it's the fusion center, information technology. He's participated in and led many investigations, and so it's the breadth of his experience over that time, and I have an awful lot of confidence in his ability to lead that organization. For me, you know, I'm an Army person, so it certainly helped that he was a battalion command sergeant major in the National Guard, and he's a tremendously accomplished soldier as well. And so I have a lot of confidence in him in doing the job, and look forward to working with him over the next 3+ years. Yes, sir.
Governor, can you give assurances or explain to people just the process? Because I think people at home are sitting waiting for power to be restored. From what you've heard from Entergy and other energy providers, what is the process in terms of just restoring power for people that are waiting and saying,
yeah. Yeah, well, first of all, it gets a little frustrating because you step out your front door and you see that the poles are up and the lines are intact, but that's not true everywhere. And you have an awful lot of vegetation that was blown down, trees into lines. You have poles in some places that were broken. And that's all distribution type damage. We also have some transmission damage. So the very large transmission towers that carry a lot of the electricity, those repairs have to be made too. And quite frankly, I think it's just a challenge of the times that we live in. People are accustomed to instant gratification. You know, when I was a kid and the lights went out, you expected the lights to be out 3-4 days a week every time it happened. But power companies have gotten much better at restoring power, and so people really want them to come back on. And the other thing is we rely on that electricity for things now that we didn't before, for example, internet and cable TV and that sort of thing. So nobody's more aware of that than the power companies and the Public Service Commission. I can tell you that they do a very good job of strategically assessing where the damage is and the sequence that they need to operate in, so that they're fixing the right things first to restore power, not just to the most people, but to the most essential infrastructure. So I told you, we've got like 18 hospitals that's currently without power, meaning they're operating on a generator. That sounds good, except that we know from experience that generators only work for so long before they have mechanical problems. We've got water systems out there. You've heard about sewer systems and lift stations. And now we have to add polling places to the list of priority locations for restoration. And so this is a little bit different this time. But I do expect, based on the type of damage that's out there, that we're going to have a electricity restored for the vast majority of people over the next day or two, but it's not going to be 100%. You know, you always hate to draw comparisons or contrasts, but Cameron Parish, that storm hit 2 months ago, and most of Cameron Parish doesn't have electricity today because of the catastrophic damage done to the transmission lines that feed electricity into that parish. It won't be anything like that here in Jefferson or in Orleans or in any other parishes. And there's just not much you can say that brings comfort to people when the lights are out, other than I can assure you that these companies are working very, very hard. There's one more complicating thing that I want to bring up. There are electricity outages in Mississippi and Alabama because of this storm that came through. And so some of the reciprocal contractual relationships that we have, we're not able to take advantage of because those linemen, those crews are needed in those states. The other thing is, in advance of Zeta's arrival in Louisiana, there was ice storms out in Texas and further west, and line crews had been deployed out there. But we are moving as many people to this area as we can. And when I say we, you know, I don't regulate the power companies. That's the Public Service Commission. But I know they're doing this because they routinely report to us. And in fact, we had a report just a few minutes ago at the Unified Command Group meeting that we did while we were here in Jefferson Parish. So I'm going to ask for people to be patient and tell you I expect the vast majority of people to have electricity relatively soon.
Governor, I know this is a fluid situation, but when you make the decision to relocate polling locations with power still out for so many people, how are you going to go about notifying them?
Yeah, that's a challenge. And quite frankly, there will be some people who won't know, and I suspect, until they pull up, and there'll be a sign at their normal polling location that will direct them to where it is they're going to have to vote. But if you have the opportunity, we're going to be using the media, and hopefully we can do this by social media, by radio, by television, and whatever means we have to identify those polling locations so that we can communicate that to the voters in advance. But you know, given how limited the time is between now and then, there is every chance that someone's going to get up and go to vote on Tuesday and be redirected then to a new polling location. Now, we hope that that's in as few places as possible, obviously, and they're going to be working very, very hard between now and then to make sure that doesn't happen any more than is necessary. Yes, ma'am.
You got a bird's eye view yesterday. Were there any areas that you saw were a major concern that you're going to focus on in future storms?
Well, one thing I want to tell people is we believe that the storm surge exceeded 10 feet at the highest point. But the levee systems that we have in Southeast Louisiana performed extremely well. And there was only one levee system that was breached. That was the Burrito levee in Grand Isle that President Cynthia Lee Shang was talking about a while ago. We're working with the Corps already and CPRA to try to get very resilient, durable repairs made as soon as possible. But the rest of the system really held up very well. Now there's significant wind damage, and I don't want to say there's no water damage, because there is in certain low-lying locations outside of protected areas. For the most part, this was a wind storm, and in terms of the impacts, and so there's damage across Southeast Louisiana. But the closer you get to the coast, and certainly it was on the right or the east side of the storm as it moved up. I haven't yet been to Plaquemines Parish. I haven't yet been to St. Bernard, but I'm going to be in both of those locations today. But I think if you look at South Terrebonne, South Lafourche, the Grand Isle areas, move up through Lafitte in Plaquemines and St. Bernard, you're going to see that's where most of the damage was. And the closer you are to the coast, the more concentrated the damage is. So I don't know for certain, but I suspect that we won't see any place where the damage is more concentrated than down around Port Fouchon in Grand Isle. But you know, we're going to be working to get people back on their feet. And the administrator was exactly right. You know, obviously, the insurance is the first way that homeowners and business owners should be trying to help themselves right now. One more question, because we've got to get to other events with the administrator here. So this will be the last question.
Estimated dollar amount of damage, yeah. Ballpark, and so far, for the burrito
levy,
how much did that
cost? I don't have an answer for that. It's going to be expensive, and we hope that working through the congressional delegation, whatever money needs to be appropriated to the Corps for that purpose, if they don't have sufficient reserves on hand to effect emergency repairs, that Congress will make that appropriation. I just don't know right now, and it is too early to guess. And quite frankly, the damage assessments are still ongoing, and there are certain thresholds that have to be met in order for us to be able to turn on public assistance and that sort of thing. And I'm not able to give those estimates yet. But as soon as we have more definition around those damage assessments, we'll be sure to communicate that to all of you. One of the bits of good news is we have at least 7 days of decent weather without precipitation, so people are going to be able to get out and make repairs to their homes. We're asking people as they clean up, as they make those repairs, to be very, very careful and make sure that you do everything you can for yourself and your family. Let's be a good neighbor to others. But being a good neighbor right now means that when you go out and you help them, or you feed them or whatever, you do it with a mask on, and for the maximum extent possible, you do it from 6 feet away. And if we will do all those things, then I'm sure that we'll be able to get through this storm too with relatively low COVID numbers. And that's incredibly important. So thank all of you. Have a wonderful weekend, and we will let you all know through the communications office what the next press availability is going to be.